Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming to our last seminar of the semester. And I commend you for coming here after after finals week. And it's a great pleasure to have today Dr. Amit Singer from Princeton University. Dr. Singer is a professor of mathematics, and he's a member of the executive committee for the PECM, the program in applied and computational math at Princeton. He joined Princeton in 2008 as an assistant professor, and he was at Yale before that as a Gibbs assistant professor in applied math, and he received his BS in physics and mathematics and his PhD in applied math from Tel Aviv University in 1997 and 2005 respectively. He got several awards, and one of them is the Moore Investigator in Data-Driven Discovery in 2014, the Simons Investigator Award, which is actually quite a prestigious award as well, and the PYI, of course, is well known for scientists and engineers, and the Alfred P. Sloan Research Fellowship in 2010. And the Chaim Nesiahu Prize for Best PhD in Mathematics in 2007 in Israel. His current research is in applied mathematics, focuses on theoretical and computational aspects of data science and computational methodologies for structural biology. It's a pleasure to have him here today. And he changed the title of us today. He's going to be talking about 3D puzzles, multi-reference alignment, and cryo-electron microscopy. And thank you for coming. The floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you, Amit, for the invitation and for the great hospitality here at North Carolina. It's really a great pleasure being here. So last night I went with Professor Kreen for dinner, and we had some discussions. And after the discussion, I decided to change the topic of the presentation today. So I hope that not to disappoint any of you got really excited about the abstract, but I decided to be more appropriate to discuss the other topic with Professor Kreen's group in a private session afterwards, because it is a bit more perhaps mathematical for a general audience. And so today I would like to discuss, like the title says, 3D puzzles, multi-reference alignment, cryo-electron microscopy. I assume that at least you know what are 3D puzzles, and I'll discuss multi-reference alignment, cryo-electron microscopy later on. So as a kid, I really liked solving jigsaw puzzles, and I assume that many of you here also have some familiarity of doing puzzles. But let's try to actually put a mathematical framework for solving a jigsaw puzzle. So if the puzzle has n pieces, so little n is the number of puzzle pieces, then what you need to figure out when you're, say, trying to reconstruct the globe, for every piece of the puzzle, you have to find out where to place it on the globe, that is a point on the unit sphere, but also you need to find its in-plane rotation. So together, you really need to find an element of the rotation group in three dimensions. And so in this case, G, capital G, is the rotation group, SO3. And we have n elements, n group elements, G1 to GN, corresponding to each of the puzzle pieces. And when we are trying to solve the puzzle, really what we are trying to do is to minimize a global cost function that is the sum of all the pairwise interactions. What I mean by that is that you try two pieces, say piece I and piece J, and you have a cost function, Fij, for every such pair of pieces that tells you how well they fit together. But how well they fit together also depends on the relative group transformation, Gi times Gj inverse. For example, if they are far apart and they don't touch each other, maybe you want to have this Fij being zero. If they overlap, then, well, you really don't want them to overlap, and so the cost function will be very high, like plus infinity or plus, say, 10 to the 15 or something like that. And if they just touch each other, well, you need to try all possible ways in which they touch each other, and for each one of them, you have some value. So you can really think of this Fij as a potential function or energy function. And what you're trying to do is to minimize the sum of all pairwise interactions. Now, the issue with trying to formulate it in this way is that you have a very large search space of parameters. I mean, you have n pieces. So for every piece, you need to find its value in the group G. So you have n copies of G, and so the search space for you is now G to the n. That is, it's exponentially large in the number of pieces in n. So if you try to do it, say, on a computer, this can take you a very long time if you just try to search the entire configuration space in this way. Of course, when we try to solve puzzles, the way we do it is that we first look for pairs of pieces that fit very well together and decide, okay, they should fit together, and we just build our way in that way. We don't look at all possible states of our configuration space. But this is because our pieces are very, well, at least when you have different colors and so on, you know how there is a clear cut when they fit or not. But with other data sets that I'll show very soon, there is no such clear cut. And you'd really like to search the entire space. So here is an example from signal processing. For example, you can think of it as an application of, in radar. And so just a problem of registration or aligning noisy signals. So for example, let's say that we have this signal, which is just a step function. And let's say that we have a shifted copy of it. And what you would like to find out is the time shift, the time delay between the two signals. Well, obviously, if there are just two clean signals and a shifted copy of one of another, with our eye, we can do the alignment. It's not very complicated. In reality, if you design the clean signal that you transmit and then you receive it at some time delay and maybe a noisy version of it, still you can do this alignment very easily, for example, by doing a match filtering or phase correlation. This would work relatively well for the noise level that I'm showing you here. But it could be the case that you actually don't know the original clean template that was transmitted. Suppose that you are some eavesdropper that just receives noisy versions of the original signal every time with some different shift, and what you observe are, say, signals that look like this. So at relatively low noise levels, when the SNR is still good enough, you can still do match filtering and phase correlation. It will still work relatively well. But if we're in a very high noise level, in a very low SNR regime, and we obtain signals like that, then, well, suddenly the method that we learned how to do registration would not work anymore. It will just give you some garbage, right? The delay that you estimate will have nothing to do with the ground truth delay parameter. And so from just pair of signals, we won't be able to estimate the time shift, and also we won't be able to estimate the original clean template. But what if we actually can measure more than just a couple of noisy signals? What if we can estimate, say, what if we can measure, say, 10 signals or 100 or in general some n noisy copies of the same underlying signal every time with some arbitrary unknown shift? Can we now leverage the fact that we have many copies and estimate the underlying clean signal, but without knowing what is the underlying clean? We don't know what is the clean signal. We don't know what are the unknown shifts. So in this problem, it's actually possible to solve this problem using a method of invariance. For example, you can come up with features that are invariant to the shift. For example, the sum of the pixel values would be invariant to a shift, or the power spectrum would be invariant to the shift. And you can also come up with higher order spectra. But in some other problems that I'll show you later today, we don't have such nice invariants. We don't have even any invariants at all. And And what you would really like to do is perhaps try all possible, in this case, group transformation. In this case, it's just shifts, and which is an exponentially large set space, and find the configuration, the set of n shifts that gives you the maximum likelihood. That is, when you just unshift all the noisy signals and put them one on top of the other, then it has to say the minimum Euclidean square distance between all pairs. But the question, how to do it in a computational tractable way, because the set space is exponentially large. And so here is a mathematical framework for doing this multi-reference alignment. So G is a group of transformations. So for example, let's say if we have a time periodic signal, then it will just be SO2. And the space of signals would be, say, square integrable signals over the unit circle. And we have a group action. So if you pick a signal and say you rotate it by an angle alpha, then this is just the group action. Okay, so it takes an element of the vector space X, the space of, say, square integrable signals or functions, and you get back just a shifted copy of it. So that's the group action. But we can play this game for other group actions. And the measurements that you observe, so here is the measurement model. So what we measure yi for signal number I, there are n of them. You take the underlying clean template, the clean signal, which is unknown. You rotate it by the group element gi. And then maybe there is also a sampling operator. That is, your measurements can be in a different space. So for example, instead of just functions over the circle, maybe we just sample it in say, some m discretization point. And so you can now formulate a quasi-maximum likelihood estimator that is equivalent to, because noise is Gaussian, it is equivalent to, say, unshifting measurement number I by GI, unshifting measurement number J by GJ. Up to noise, this should be the same. This should give you X. And so really, we want to minimize this sum of square Euclidean distances. And so you see this multi-reference alignment problem, it just falls under the general framework that I showed earlier for solving the 3D puzzle. Again, for every pair of signals, I and J, you have some function Fij that depends on the group ratio, Gi, Gj inverse, right? I can just put the Gi over here. And we want to minimize this global cost function. But the question is how to do it in a computationally tractable way. By the way, feel free to stop me at any time with questions. Okay, the third application that I would like to discuss is coming from the field of structural biology, where the goal is to find three-dimensional structures of macromolecules. And one of the emerging techniques nowadays is called single-particle cryo-electron microscopy. And perhaps you're familiar with the more traditional way of finding a three-dimensional structure using X-ray crystallography. But for X-ray crystallography, one needs to be able to crystallize the molecules. That is to find chemical or physical conditions in which all molecules are arranged on a regular lattice, all of them pointing in the same direction in three space. But it's often the case where people do not know how to crystallize a given molecule, like a protein. And so instead, in a cryo-electron microscopy, what they do, they just freeze the molecules in a very, very thin layer of ice. So the ice layer is so thin that if you look at it in the vertical direction, you'd see at most one molecule, but there is just no room for two molecules to be one on top of the other. And at the moment of freezing, every molecule just picks some random and unknown orientation inside the ice layer, and also some random position. So really what you can visualize it in your, so say, for yourself as a random soup of molecules embedded, a two-dimensional soup of molecules embedded in this ice layer. And then in order to view it, what you do, you shoot an electron beam using the electron microscope perpendicular to the ice layer. The electron beam goes through the ice layer, through the molecule, if there is a molecule there. And beneath you have a film or a camera. And the pixel intensity is proportional to the path integral of the electric potential created by the molecule. The molecule is made of atoms that have some electron cloud and so on. So it creates a potential function, electric potential. And this is what you measure. So here what you see is not a real experiment. It's just artist concept, okay, in which this corresponds to, say, the micrograph, where you observe 2D projection images of the 3D molecules. The first step that usually needs to be taken is to do image segmentation, in which you crop little boxes out of the micrograph where you believe that the particles are. And then the 3D problem is to go from the 2D images, the 2D particle images, for which you don't know the viewing direction, and reconstruct the 3D structure of the molecule. That's the cryo-EM problem. And cryo-EM is really gaining popularity nowadays. So for example, if you were to read the latest issue of Science magazine, just from last week, there was a lab at NIH that reported a reconstruction using cryo-EM at 2.2 angstrom resolution. So it's really getting to atomic scale resolution of what you can get using X-ray crystallography, but without actually crystallizing. And this improvement in the resolution is due to new detector technology that I will not describe today, but the method of cryo-EM is really becoming more and more popular among structural biologists. So what is the image formation model in cryo-EM, what I just described earlier in words? So we have a molecule that we don't know its structure. So we describe it by a function phi. So phi is just the electric potential of the molecule, a function from the three space variables, and it gives you the electric potential at every location. And the images are two-dimensional. So let's say it has every image, you have a local coordinate system, say the x direction and the y direction. And so the xy pixel in image number I is just the path integral of the electric potential phi after you rotated phi by this unknown element of SO3, rotation RI. So you rotated it, and then you integrate in the z direction. Okay, so you integrate the molecule. After integrating the z direction, you just end up with a function of x and y. But of course, there is also noise. And where noise is coming from is also related to the fact that this method is called single particle reconstruction. So single particle means that we have only one image per molecule. So in single particle reconstruction, you are not allowed to take multiple images of the same molecule. So what you see here is just the same as the X-ray transform in a computerized tomography, very popular, say, in medical imaging. But in medical imaging, when, say, you have to do MRI or a CT scan of a patient, the patient is being asked not to move for the duration of the imaging process. And during that time, the machine would scan, say, the brain or some other organ from different viewing directions. And the viewing directions are known if the patient is actually not moving. But with the molecule, we don't know their own intentions. But we can still play the same game of, say, tilting the specimen. Right? We can tilt the ice layer, say, by 10 degrees and then by another 10 degrees and so on. But this is actually not being done in single particle reconstruction. And the reason why it's not being done is because of radiation damage. That is, as the electron beam goes through the molecule, it has so high intensity that it actually breaks down the chemical bonds that make the molecule. But if you really want to get to high resolution, like two-angstrom resolution or three-angstrom resolution that the biologists care about, then you are not allowed to use too much of an electron dose. And in particular, you are not allowed to take more than one image per molecule. And so this is like Mission Impossible. Once you heard the message, it destroyed itself. Okay, so you are not allowed to take more than one image per molecule. And so the cryo-EM problem is an inverse problem in which you want to reconstruct phi, to estimate phi, from a set of noisy tomographic images, I1 to IN. Of course, if you can somehow estimate the rotations, R1 to RN, then you've reduced the problem to a classical problem in computerized tomography. That's the medical imaging problem, which is a well-known problem that people invested a lot of time in how to solve it, and by now it's very well understood. But the cryo-EM problem is more challenging because we don't know those rotations. So we have projection images at completely unknown directions. So here is a toy example. We say clean images of what's going on. Suppose you don't know this 3D structure, and I just show you, say, 12 projection images that you see below. Can you figure out the 3D structure? So here maybe you've seen, I don't know, maybe enough Disney movies in your lifetime, and based on some of the images, you can make some clever guesses of what is the 3D structure. But with real microscope images of real molecules, the task is much more complicated. Okay, so what I show you here is just four samples out of a much larger data set of 27,000 particle images. And the task is to find a 3D structure. So first of all, you need to convince yourself that you're not just staring at just white noise or a colored noise here. So perhaps if you look very close let's say, the center of the images, then you see that the pixels there are somewhat brighter. Okay, so and that's why we believe that there is a molecule there, and that's actually how the particle picking algorithm actually picks those particles. And now to show that actually there is a signal there, I'll show you a 3D reconstruction that was done by two of my former students. And what you'll see in here is a movie that shows you two different structures, one in yellow, one in white. The yellow one is actually the ground truth, and the white is our reconstruction from the 27,000 experimental images that I showed you before. And so you see that the two structures are quite similar, which means that we are doing probably some good job in the reconstruction. There are some differences. And you can ask me, how do I know the ground truth here? So that's actually a subunit of a molecule called the ribosome, for which the Nobel Prize in Chemistry was awarded in 2009. And the structure was determined by X-ray crystallography. So at least in the cases where we can compare to X-ray crystallography, you see that we get similar results. So now the question is, how did we find this 3D structure? Okay, I need to now reveal what's going on into the reconstruction. So actually, there are several algorithmic challenges for cryo-EM. Already, well, maybe step zero is the particle picking that I discussed before.
Yeah, of the same thing.
So different molecules, yeah, but the basic assumption is that all molecules have exactly the same 3D structure.
Right, but you have 27 of them.
27,000.
1,000 of them.
Yeah.
Maybe even more, but maybe the particle picking procedure did not pick all of them.
Okay. Yeah. So earlier you were saying that we look at it once. So we're looking at one molecule once, but we actually have 27,000 identical molecules.
Right.
Okay.
So the main challenge in what I described so far is to find the rotations, R1 to RN. This is the orientation assignment problem. But there are, of course, many other challenges. For example, the problem of heterogeneity. What to do when not all 27,000 molecules are completely identical? And we know that in reality, molecules have different conformations. Like proteins, they can have say protein channels, they can come in an open state or a closed state, but the images are just like they are unlabeled in terms of the rotation, they are also unlabeled in terms of the conformation state. And sometimes you don't even know how many states there are and if it's a discrete space or continuous space. This is also a major issue. There are other challenges, like can we just denoise the images directly without finding their orientation? Can we detect maybe the point group symmetry of the molecule by just looking at the 2D images? How to do motion correction with those new cameras? And so there are actually many interesting challenges that have to do both with classical imaging, image processing, more recent advances in image processing and geometry of data. But today I would like to focus on the problem of orientation estimation. And so how is this problem is classically solved? I mean, most cryo-EM labs, they don't wait for us for mathematicians to figure out how to do this problem the right way. They just use what they know, you know, to quickly get answers. And so the standard procedure is something that they call iterative refinement. So what is iterative refinement? It's basically just an algorithm which you can think of it either as alternating minimization or a more fancy version of it is using EM, expectation maximization. And so what we are trying to solve is to find phi and rotations that satisfies as best as possible this image formation model. So the image formation model is that we rotate the molecule by rotation RI, and then we project it, right? So we do the X-ray projection and sample it on a grid and add noise to it, and this is how we get our ice image. So one way that you can solve this problem is to say, okay, let's guess some structure, say phi naught, and if we guessed phi naught, let's say that last night after dinner I had a really good dream on how the molecule should look like, and I have a good guess for phi naught. And given phi naught, I can find the best rotations that fit my data. So the way you can do it, for example, you can just project phi naught in many different directions, and then for every experimental image, you can find, say for the raw experimental images, you can just do template matching to find the best template that matches them. And once you assign the best template that matches them, you actually assign the rotation. So now for given phi naught, you know the rotations. Once you know the rotations, what do you do next? Well, now you're in the classical medical imaging problem. So you can reconstruct a new molecule. Now you have phi 1. What do? You repeat this process iteratively until convergence. Question?
So my understanding is that you're trying to basically do some type of maximal likelihood of the reconstruction and the projections. But it's known that in some settings, maximum likelihood doesn't give the best solution. So do you have some rationale why you're going for maximum likelihood? Is that because that's the best that we can do, or anything else?
Yeah. So of course, later you can think of more sophisticated things like adding regularization. Like if you have some prior knowledge about how the molecule should look like, and so on. But maximum likelihood has very nice properties. For example, like asymptotic consistency, and that at the moment, let's just try to figure out how to solve this problem before we try to do anything more complicated than that. Okay, so. So this is what people use. They just use this iterative refinement procedure. And, well, it converges. You can show that at every step you reduce some cost function. But it will only converge to some local optimum, but not necessarily the global one. And it can very much depend on your initial guess on phi naught. So maybe I choose phi naught and I converge to some molecule, and maybe Hamid chose a different phi naught and he converged to a different molecule. And so, and it is well known that model bias, that we have the phenomenon of model bias, that is the structure that we'll get in this way really depends on our starting point. So the question is, can we somehow come up with a structure in a completely reference-free way? Just let the data speak for itself without having us inject or impose some our idea on how the molecule should look like, some guess for finite. Just let the noisy projection images speak for themselves and find phi just from them. So I would like to show you today that this is actually doable and it's actually going to fall exactly to the same framework of optimization problem that I posed in the very beginning for the 3D puzzle. So to make our life easier for today, I'm going to assume that the molecule has a trivial point group symmetry. That is, it does not have any special point group symmetry, although symmetry actually helps, okay? And maybe we can discuss later how it helps. And also I'm going to make the assumption of homogeneity. That is, there are no heterogeneous structures in my sample. And so the basic tool that we need to use is from computerized tomography. It's called the Fourier projection slice theorem. What the Fourier projection slice theorem tells us is how to relate the 2D Fourier transform of the projection images with the 3D Fourier transform of the 3D molecules. So the theorem says that if you take the 2D Fourier transform of a projection image, so let's say II hat is just the 2D Fourier transform of the ice projection image, then if there is no noise, then the values of this 2D Fourier transform are nothing but the restriction of the 3D Fourier transform to a planar slice that goes through the origin in the 3D reciprocal space, in the Fourier space. So that is really how classical commutarized tomography works. So if you know the viewing directions, let's say in CT reconstruction, then basically you have measurements of the 3D Fourier space on planar slices that go through the origin. And once you have enough sampling, once you have enough planes that go through the origin, then you can simply do 3D Fourier inversion, right? And get the density map in the real space. Now in the cryo-EM problem, we know that the projection images correspond to slices that go through the origin, but they are unorganized. Okay? So just like our 3D puzzle, we need to somehow figure out how all these 3D, how these 2D planes in 3D, how they should really be fit together. So luckily there is some very simple geometry that we can employ here, and that's something that we probably all learned in elementary school or high school, that if you take two planes in R3, unless they are parallel, they are going to intersect at a line, right? So this means that if I'm going to look at two projection images, say image I and image J, then in their 2D Fourier representation, there are going to be one line, say the red line in image I, and the red line in image J, on which the 2D Fourier transforms are exactly the same. They agree. Why? Because they just correspond to the same line in the 3D Fourier space. So if there was no noise in the images, then we can actually find that line by, say, simply computing the 2D Fourier transform of image I on, say, a polar grid, and also for image J on a polar grid, and then just, say, correlate every line in image J with every line in image I, and look for the pair of lines that give us the, say, the maximum, say, correlation or the minimum Euclidean distance. And that would be our guess for the common line. So once we know the common line, we know where the two planes intersect. Now, still, this does not tell us the relative rotation between the two images. And the reason being is that there is still 1 degree of freedom left. that is the angle between the two planes. So SO3, the group of rotations over R3, is described by three parameters, right? So let's say the three Euler angles. So this tells us two out of the three Euler angles, but we are still missing one. And so a way to figure out the missing angle is to add a third plane. And so once you know the common lines between three images, between three planes, then this uniquely determines the configuration up to a global rotation and possibly a reflection. So this goes back to the 80s, and it was discovered independently in the East and in the West. It's called the angular reconstitution algorithm. So you can start with three images, find the common lines between them, and then add the fourth image and the fifth image, and for every image that you add, you can figure out based on its common lines with the previous images, you can figure out its rotation. Yeah.
In this case, this is very nice, but when there's noise, then, you know, the simple case would be that you're not getting the exact line, but a wiggly version of the line, and the bad case is that there's so much noise that, like, the line that you're estimating to be the intersection is completely different.
Right.
So how do you deal with that?
Yeah, so you're preaching to the choir. Now I'm going to tell you how to do it.
Okay.
So what Roy is saying is completely right, of course. So angular reconstitution is a very nice algorithm, but unfortunately, it's only of theoretical interest. In practice, it's a complete failure. It will not take you anywhere. And the reason is because the images that I showed you before are so noisy that the prediction or the estimation of the common lines between pairs of images is usually just meaningless. So Drew is right by saying that if the images are clean, then it is just like our 3D puzzle problem. It is we start with two images, and we figure out how they should be put together, and then we add a third piece and a fourth piece and so on, and we just solve the puzzle. But in reality, when you look at a pair of images and we try to find their common line, usually the estimation is poor. And so to show you that this is the case, let's do just a very simple simulation. So here is a clean projection image of say the subunit of the ribosome that I just added wide Gaussian noise at different level of signal to noise ratio. So perhaps the experimental images correspond to SNR of 2^-6 or 2^-7. And then here is a table that shows us, because it's a simulation, okay, I know what are the rotations and what should be the common lines. Here is a table that shows the detection rate of the common lines as a function of the signal to noise ratio. So 2^-6 or 2^-7, only say 10% of, for the pairs of images, we actually find the common line correctly. So this means that for angular reconstitution to work, you should be extremely lucky. I mean, if you pick three images, only 1 in 1,000, the three common lines will be detected correctly. And even if that's the case, like we were told, we're going to make some small errors. And then the fourth image and the fifth image, for sure, it will give us it will just, at some point, it will break down and errors will just accumulate and propagate. And so the question is, can we come up with an approach that will somehow fuse all the geometric information together and not just work sequentially by starting with three images and then add the fourth image and fifth image and so on. So my first approach to this problem was using perhaps being trained as an applied mathematician. The first thing that you try to do is least squares. Okay, so what do I mean by a least squares approach? Yeah. What is the least squares approach? We can write actually linear equations here. So let's say that we find the common line between image I and image A, and we denote it by just a point on the unit circle, say xij, yij, in the coordinate system of image I. And so let's define cij this planar vector. Okay, unit, this is the unit vector just in the xy plane. I just concatenate this direction vector with zero. So what we know is that if we take this vector, Cij, and now rotate it by Ri, it will take it to its true location in 3D. And similarly, if we take CJI, okay, this vector concatenated with zero, and rotate it by RJ, this will take it also to its correct location in 3D, but that's actually the same location because it's the common line. And so you get the linear equation RICAJ equals RJCJI. So now this can be viewed as great news. Why? Because we need to estimate n rotations, okay, R1 to Rn. So we have order of n variables, but we can write an order of n squared equation for every I and j. And so we can think about minimizing just a quadratic cost function, just the squared Euclidean distance between RICAJ with RJCJI, and to think of it as solving a system of linear equations. The issue is that we want the solution to be in the rotation group, SO3. And this makes the problem much more nastier, okay? Because now it's a non-convex optimization problem, because the rotation group is non-convex. If you pick two rotations and you average them, you typically end up with a matrix which is not a rotation matrix. And so some of my earlier work was to relax this problem into, say, a spectral algorithm that only requires to compute eigenvectors and eigenvalues, or more tight semi-definite programming relaxation. This is related to Max Cut and something called the non-commutative Grothendieck. But and this you can find in this paper. But I don't want to go into the details of this because I now want to switch into the previous formulation. That is also I want to claim that this approach of least squares is suboptimal because you are not using all the information in the images. That is, you're only using the information encoded by the common lines, only the geometric information that you squeezed out of the images by comparing pairs. But really, this idea of comparing pairs can only work in the highest NR regime, just like we saw for the problem of multi-reference alignment. I mean, for you to be able to detect the common line correctly, I mean, the detection rate goes down exponentially fast if the SNR goes to zero. So in some sense, even if you're trying to compare all pairs, it's like you're trying to fight an exponential disease with a polynomial cure, okay? It's not going to help you above some noise level. So what we really like to do is the same maximum likelihood approach that we did before. That is, we'd like to somehow search the entire configuration space of rotations. Suppose that I can do it, let's say it's computational tractable. Okay? And for every set of rotations, I can figure out what are the common lines, go back to the images, and just see how these common lines agree with each other. I mean, just the pixel values on those lines. So the question is just how to do it in a computational tractable way. So now I want to show that indeed you can also formulate this problem in the same way. Oh, here I'm missing the sum. Okay, the same sum that appears here. Just in the same way that we formulated the two previous problems. So maybe we skip the geometric considerations, but it turns out that those CIJ, CJIs, they're only a function of the relative ratio between rotation I and rotation J. And then you just restrict the images, the Fourier transform, to those lines. And then it only depends. So now the group is SO3. The G1 to GN that you see here are just the inverses of the rotations, the RIs. And so again, you can just write this optimization problem with minimizing the sum of squared interactions. So all these problems take this form. And actually, there are many other problems that I didn't discuss today in computer vision, computer graphics, that all of them have this formulation. And now I'd like to show you that whenever the group G is compact, like SO2, SO3, then we can solve this kind of problems in a computational tractable way. So the main idea, so there are going to be maybe two or three main ideas. The first one, we're going to use the Fourier transform over the group. Okay, so perhaps we're all familiar with the Fourier transform over SO2. So you have a function over the circle, or which is over SO2. So think now of alpha as the rotation corresponding to the angle corresponding to the rotation in SO2. And you can expand this function in a Fourier series. So the F at K are just the Fourier coefficients. And we know how to compute them by just integrating over the group. Right? This is just the Fourier inversion formula. These are the Fourier coefficients. But actually, you can do this over any compact group that has irreducible representations. So in general, you have this formula that you can write the function over the group, okay, as a sum over all the irreducible representations. Dk is just the dimension of the representation. For example, it's just one. You don't see the dk's here. It's just one for SO2. And then the e to the ik alpha is replaced by rho k of g. So rho k is a unitary matrix for every g. And it's a representation. And f at k are matrices of size dk by dk. This is also a unitary matrix of size dk by dk. And the Fourier coefficients are just given to you by integration over the group. So you integrate the function over the group, but you have to multiply by the representation. So this complex conjugate is, for example, in SO2, you'll get e to the minus ik alpha because we have to take the complex conjugate here. Okay, but this holds for any group like SO3, you'll get representations of size 2k plus 1. Okay, these are called the Wigner D matrices that are related to spherical harmonics. But we can play this game for any group. So this is just generalization of the Fourier transform, even to non-abelian groups like SO3 that are non-commutative. Okay, now we have this cost function that we try to minimize. And it is a nonlinear function over a group. And so what we're going to do now is to linearize it. And the way that we're going to linearize it is by introducing matrix variables. So for every order of representation k, we're going to introduce a matrix xk whose ij's entry is going to be the matrix rho k, or the representation of gi gj inverse. Okay, so these are now going to be the variables that we would like to estimate. Of course, if I can estimate them, then I can figure out what are the GIs. For example, going to the first order representation with k equals to 1. But more importantly, this means that I can write the cost function for the pair ij. I just need to replace rho kg by xijk. And so I end up that the global cost function can be written in this way. Okay, so I just plug in the Fourier series for Fij. I plug it in here. So I get a sum k goes from 0 to infinity. And I replace the rho kgs by xijk. So now you see that the cost function in the n group elements becomes linear in those matrices. So now we have a linear cost function. Any questions? Okay, this linear cost function, well, I can trivially minimize it by setting all the xijk's to 0, okay? So I need some restrictions on the xijk's. They cannot be anything. They need to satisfy some set of constraints. So let's see what set of constraints they need to satisfy. So I claim that, well, they need to satisfy at least those three constraints. So for every k, the matrix xk is positive semi-definite. On the diagonal, we have identity matrices of size dk by dk. And the rank of this matrix for each k needs to be dk. Why is this the case? Well, we're just going to use the fact that Rho k is a representation. So the ijth element is rho k of gi gj inverse. Because it's a representation, well, I'm going to use the fact that it's a homomorphism. So it's rho k gi times rho k of gj inverse. So, and because it's a unitary representation, I can replace this inverse by a complex conjugate. And then we see that we can just write the matrix xk as putting all the rho k gi's one on top of the other in one, say, tall and thin matrix times its complex conjugate transpose. So you see that from this factorization, this is a positive semi-definite matrix. And the rank of this matrix is just the number of columns, which is dk. And on the diagonal, well, if you take I equals to j, then it's just a representation of the identity element of the group, which it must be the identity matrix. And so that's why we have this constraints. But still, we can have a trivial solution of all the Xij's k's, the off-diagonal elements, being zero. So we haven't gotten so far, but even including all these constraints. So some constraints are still missing. So I need more constraints that would somehow relate different order of representations. What are these constraints? So, for example, if we think of the case of SO2, well, we know that the first order representation, so the representation were e to the ik alpha. So, for example, e to the I alpha and e to the 2i alpha, they are, of course, related in a nonlinear way. E to the 2i alpha is just the squared of e to the I alpha. But relating them in this way is a nonlinear constraint. And it will give me a lot of trouble to try to impose nonlinear constraints in a computational efficient framework. So I'm looking for linear constraints. So here is a linear constraint. Let's think about the delta function over SO2. So we can write a delta function in this way, right? The Fourier coefficient of the delta function are all one. So we can write it in this way. And now let's shift the delta function to alpha I minus alpha j. Okay, so this will be the analog of gi gj inverse. So when we shift it, then we just get now this infinite summation. And recall that e to the minus ik alpha I minus alpha j is simply xijk conjugate transpose. Right? You're just taking the complex conjugate. Right? Because what is xijk? It's just e to the ik and the angle difference. And so you see the delta function, I can now relate, using the delta function, I can now relate all the matrix representations of different orders. Okay? Before, I didn't have any connection between different representations. They were all for each individual k. But now the delta function relates different order of representations. Okay, but how do I impose that this sum should be the delta function? Well, I'm going to relax it. I know that the delta function is everywhere non-negative. So I have this constraint about positivity of this linear combination of my variables. For every alpha, I can write this constraint. And also, the integral of the delta function should be 1. But what is the integral? All the terms in this sum will give me 0 instead of k equals to 0. So the integral in this case, just saying that the zero order representation, the trivial representation, is just 1, okay, which we know. Okay, so already this 1 drives the coefficients away from 0. And then all the other coefficients, well, they cannot be 0 because then the cost function would not be minimized. So they can be now positive or negative, but they're not free to be anything, because they need to satisfy this positivity constraint for every alpha. Now, still, this is something that we cannot use computationally, because I cannot put on my machine infinite number of matrices, okay, for every k, okay, for infinite number of representations. So we need now to do finite truncation. And so the finite truncation means, for example, that we are not summing from minus infinity to infinity, but also only from minus n to n. But if you do this kind of truncation, you end up with what is called the Dirichlet kernel. And it is well known that the Dirichlet kernel is no longer everywhere positive. Okay? It actually oscillates and becomes both positive and negative. And then I cannot write such non-negativity constraints. And actually, this oscillation is also the source in signal processing to what we know as the Gibbs phenomena. That is, the Fourier series does not converge uniformly to the original function. But we learn in Fourier analysis or in signal processing that there is a simple remedy to the Gibbs phenomena by replacing the Dirichlet kernel with the Fourier kernel. What is the Fourier kernel? The Fourier kernel is simply what is called the first order Cesaro mean of the Dirichlet kernel. Or a different way to look at it is simply filtering in the Fourier space by just multiplying with this very simple linear filter. And this leads to what Fourier proved. It's a very simple proof that this kernel is actually everywhere non-negative. And so what we are going to write are, and not only that, that if you use the Fourier kernel, then you actually get, you are no longer suffering from the Gibbs phenomena. You get uniform convergence of the Fourier series to the original function. Okay, so what we're going to use is those very classical ideas from Fourier analysis, and now write linear inequalities using the Fourier kernel. 5 minutes, very good. And actually, there is a generalization of this idea to any compact group. So over any compact group, we can take the delta function over the group and write it in this way. And just like we had the Fourier kernel over SO2, one can also have a Fourier kernel over SO3. Actually, over SO3, you have to take the second order Cesaro mean to get a positive kernel. But you can actually do it over any compact group. And so to summarize, what I showed you is that we can solve an SDP, a semi-definite program, for the matrices X0 up to Xn that correspond to the different irreducible representations of the group. Why it's a semi-definite program? Because all these matrices, as we said, need to be positive semi-definite. And also they need to satisfy some linear constraints, equalities and inequalities. And also the cost function is linear in those variables. So overall, we end up with a semi-definite program. Where each of these matrices needs to be positive semi-definite. And actually, they may have different sizes. For SO2, they all have the same size. But for different groups, for example, SO3, this is just a matrix of size n by n, and this will be, and they have different sizes. So based on the order of representation. Now, so you can ask me, okay, how does the solution to this semi-definite program relate to the original non-convex optimization problem? So here is something that we cannot prove theoretically at the moment, but numerically, what we observe is very promising. What we observe is that the solution to the semi-definite program has the desired rank up to a certain level of noise. So as you crank, so for, let's say, you start from no noise at all, you get the exact correct rank, meaning that you actually solved the non-convex optimization problem. Now, you add up the noise a little bit, you still get a desired rank. And then there is a phase transition once you cross a certain level of noise. And then the ranks shoot up higher. But up to that level of noise, you actually solve a non-convex optimization problem, the original optimization problem, using this semi-definite program that runs to any accuracy in polynomial time. So even though the search space is exponentially large, we can actually find the maximum likelihood estimator in polynomial time. And we get a certificate that we actually found the global solution because we look at the ranks. And because the SDP is a relaxation, if it actually comes up with the correct ranks, then it must be the case that it actually found for us the solution to the original problem, because we actually search in a much larger space. So if the solution has this special property of being low rank, then it must be the global solution. And this sets it apart, actually, from the other heuristic that I described earlier, such as alternate minimization or expectation maximization, that do not have this nice property, in the sense that you converge, but all you can guarantee is that you converge to some local optimizer, but not necessarily the global one. So here with the SDP, whenever it gave you the correct ranks, then you know. You can declare victory. You have found the global solution to the maximum likelihood estimation problem. So with this, I would like to finish, and thank you all.